broadcasting live 4 days a week worldwide
from the sunny beaches of Southern California.
This is ExtremeHealthRadio.com.
Hi, this is Dr. Robert O. Young with the PH Miracle Center, phmiracle.com, and enjoy Extreme Health Radio with Justin and Kate. They are incredible folks. They have unbelievable information, and they share it freely. So tune in daily.
Okay, today is a monumental day, isn't it?
You beat me to the punch. I was going to say, today is one of your favorite days of the entire year.
I have control of the soundboard here, don't I?
You sure do.
I do. So today's a big day in my world.
Why is that?
It's the first day of spring. Spring has sprung.
Spring has sprung.
Is that right? Today is...
March 20th, yes.
March
2014,
20th.
And it has sprung.
I love that.
I know.
I tell you, I'm such a big fan of spring.
I know.
It's my favorite time of year.
Well, it's funny because you're such a summer guy and people would peg you as a summer lover. You love summer more than anyone I know.
Yeah.
But your theory behind it is summer here by the beach half the time isn't as beautiful as you think it's going to be. It has this marine layer and never quite warms up.
And more people come into town because they're on vacation.
Right.
It's crowded.
Spring is actually ideal. Because the weather's amazing, it's clear, and the crowds aren't here.
Kids are in school, so when
right?
I go surfing,
that's right.
There's not a lot of crowds in the
shove
water.
Shove little kids out of the way.
Dude, I have to
get on your wave.
That's right. Spring is amazing. I love it.
Well, happy spring, everybody.
Happy spring. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. This is ExtremeHealthRadio.com/220. This is episode 220, and this is March 20th. Is that right?
Correct.
2000. Gosh, I have 2014 on my thing.
That's
I'm sorry,
right.
13. I need to change that. 2014. So thank you, everybody, for joining us. I really appreciate it. Today, we have Kevin Behan on the show, and we're going to be talking about some really interesting topics regarding your dog and my dog.
So great. Our dog, yeah.
Yeah, we're going to be talking about why dogs do what they do, why they behave the way they behave, some of the emotional connections between the animal, furry little four-leggeds, and us, and what that relationship means. And he's written a book called Your Dog is Your Mirror, and we're going to be talking about that, the emotional capacity of our dogs and ourselves. So we'll introduce him in just a moment. I just want to let everybody know, if you guys would like to join us live, there's lots of different ways to do that or get your questions answered. You can go to extremehealthradio.com/live and listen to the show, join the chat room, and you can interact with the guests, ask your questions there. And that's a great way to do that. And you can also email justin@extremehealthradio.com.
Or Kate, K-A-T-E, @extremehealthradio.com.
And if you'd like ever to send us a voicemail that we can play on the show, there's links to that on the website. So you can interact in many different ways. And also, if you would like to support our show and keep it free, all 220 shows we've done are free.
Good night.
Yeah, so we work for you guys for free, and we don't charge anything for any of the information. So if you would like to support us in a unique way, you can go to extremehealthradio.com/Amazon every single time you make your purchase on Amazon, and that will help keep the shows free. We'll get a couple bucks for your order, and that will make sure that we can keep offering these types of shows for you free of charge. We don't want to charge anybody for this stuff.
Yeah.
It's too important, I think, isn't it?
Mm.
People need it.
Yeah, from the amount of emails we get in and people talking about things, it's definitely necessary to spread the word and get people healthy and turned on to what's going on.
Yeah, don't want to charge at all for any of this information. So in order to do that, we have to, you know, offer things like Amazon and donations and things like that. So feel free to do that if you would like to keep the show free for everybody. And today we have Kevin Behan on the show. And we normally talk about health, but this is, you know, dogs do make us healthier.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Having a dog does make us healthier. And he's been training dogs all his life. He grew up in a family that trains dogs. He trains with his dad. And he lives up in Vermont, I think. And he's written a couple books called Natural Dog Training. He wrote that one about 20 years ago. The Canine Arts Kennel Program. Teach your dog by using his natural instincts, as well as Your Dog is Your Mirror, The Emotional Capacity of Our Dogs and Ourselves. And his website is naturaldogtraining.com. So thanks a lot, Kevin, for being on the show today.
It's my pleasure to be here, Justin and Kate. In fact, I'm grateful to be here and appreciate the forum you provide.
Oh,
the main information on your site.
Oh, you're so welcome. Did I get that right? You are up in Vermont, is that right?
Yes. Yep, I'm in the southeast corner of Vermont, and winter is losing its grip today.
Oh.
I mean, if you love dogs, you love winter, because they love winter, rolling in the snow and all that. But I do love the release of the grip as well, so it's really nice.
Yeah, you guys have had a pretty cold winter, haven't you?
Yeah, it's been a real old-fashioned one, with 10 below zero, 20 below zero once in a while. And north of us, we're in the southern half, and north of us, it's another 10 degrees colder. So this has been a good, rugged, old-fashioned winter that apparently is optimal for the sugar maple.
So
they're doing really well. Super cold nights, they really flourish in those conditions. So that's good for everything.
Oh, amazing.
Wow, at least something does. We wouldn't. We'd roll over and die.
You know, I was going to ask you, is there a specific protocol people should go after if they're going to get a dog? Should they think and consider where they live? Like, for example, you know, if you're going to be living up north where it's cold, would it be better to get a dog that's more adapt to that environment?
I think so. I mean, I feel bad for huskies in Florida in the summer.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, you have to say, you see people flourishing everywhere with every kind of dog. And if I lived in the north, I would definitely want something real hardy. But everybody's different. I mean, when it comes to the connection between a given person and a dog, it's all chemistry. So follow their heart, and they'll end up with a dog that they should have. So, but I would, you know, as a general guideline, that makes sense.
Yeah, because I wonder about, I've seen that before where you have these huskies in Florida, and I think, oh, that's so sad. You know, their fur is so thick, and here they are, it's 80 degrees or 90 or 100. And
I know.
That's got to be tough.
I used to be really active in importing shepherds from Germany, and there's a huge dog training movement down south, and you could see them have a hard time adjusting to the change of temperature, and their coats would suffer. And so it takes special care to keep them really optimal in the hot weather. But I like to think of a husky wallowing.
Oh,
that's the way it should be.
What kind of dogs do you have yourself these days?
I have a shepherd, kind of a shepherd person from my background with working dogs, police dogs.
Uh-huh.
And we invariably have a small dog, and our small dog of choice, we love corgis. So we have a rescue corgi we're rehabilitating at the moment.
Mm.
And we're chronicling that journey.
There
should be some pretty good information on that on my website. And, you know, all kinds of dogs over the years. But primarily, I would say I'm a shepherd and corgi combo person.
Oh, that's a great combo. Those corgis are something,
aren't
they? Yeah,
corgi's like a little... He's like a big Rottweiler in a little body. So.
I know. They think they're so tough, don't they?
They walk around all muscled up. And,
Yeah, I would like to touch on that today as far as the rehabbing of dogs and the, you know... It seems like every week there's not a day that goes by that somebody says, oh, we just rescued a dog and we're rehabbing him, or he's been through this or that. And, you know, you kind of cringe going, oh, I wonder how that's going to work with the kids or the family, or these dogs have so many issues and stuff. But it sounds like you have a lot of background in providing people hope that animals really can kind of change. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's actually most of the work I do these days is working with dogs that a lot of them are in our neck of the woods, who are coming from down south. All these volunteers who find them, a lot more stray dog population down there, and they find them and they bring them up here and then work tirelessly to find homes for them.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, our corgi came from Alabama. So, yeah, it's quite an extensive network. If my general advice to people with young kids and everything is to get a puppy and raise it very gently, and I would have to say with young families with young children, I would raise a puppy from the very beginning treat it very gently, teach the children how to respect the puppy, treat the puppy gently, and that's how I would recommend anyone to go about it with your little kids.
Oh,
but
yeah.
If someone is a real dog person and they're really dedicated, then it can be very rewarding to take a dog that was going to probably be destroyed and give it a new lease on life.
Do you think it matters if people, young couples, are getting dogs? Is there a difference between getting a dog before a woman gives birth to a baby or after introducing the dog after the child is born? Is there a difference there, do you think?
You know, there should not be. I mean, we've gotten dogs, 4-year-old dogs that I imported for breeding purposes became my family dog. Mm-hmm. And I already had children and a little dog, and they fit into anything. So most people probably have the most amount of trouble when they have a dog and then they have a child. And the problem that happens is if people don't understand the nature of the dog doesn't feel connected to his owner by how much attention he gets. He feels connected by this sense of teamwork that they may or may not have established. So if you have a real strong rapport, emotional rapport, then the more children in the mix, the better, the more energy, and the dog won't have an adjustment problem. But if the dog's definition of being connected to its owner is by way of how much attention it receives, mm-hmm. those dogs have trouble when you bring in a new child, a baby.
So you want to make sure you don't give them too much attention, do you think?
Exactly. Yeah, they don't do well with a lot of attention. They become, I call it, addicted to owner syndrome. And then wherever the owner shifts their gaze and pays attention and invests their energy, the dog starts to feel disconnected. So, you know, if you see a dog that's following a person everywhere and is pining for them when they leave them alone, separation anxiety and things like that, that dog doesn't actually feel connected to the owner, which is why it's constantly seeking affirmation.
Oh.
It's the opposite of the way people would perceive it. They think the dog is so devoted to them, so bonded to them, he can't bear to be without them, but it's actually the opposite.
So a lot of what you talk about is like flow and the emotional connection between animals, or more specifically dogs, to their owners. And most of what you talk about is really interesting, is so opposite, like you were just talking about with this whole thing with separation anxiety in animals. Most of what you teach and the way you train and teach people how to train is opposite of people like Caesar Milan and all these types of people. Which is really interesting. How do you come up with this whole separate, opposite way of dealing with dogs?
It's kind of a long story, but yeah, I mean, you touched on the most important word is flow. Everything about it, all animals, and it's most obvious with dogs, it's all about flow. Mm-hmm. So there's many things that, I mean, if you look at all the great trainers in the world, and everybody has different philosophies, and some are diametrically opposed to each other, so it's very confusing. But if you see what works for any trainer, no matter what their philosophy might be, it's all flow that is successful. So you look at Caesar, and he does a lot of flow stuff. He gives dogs exercises. He rollerblades with them. He plays with them. So he does a lot of flow stuff, but his language gets him bogged down with this dominant hierarchy, which is order for the sake of order, and that knocks the whole system out of the flow, and that's where people would have trouble with that method. And then in counterbalance, you have the positive dog people, and they're absolutely aghast at Caesar. And what they do with treats and positive experiences, the extent to which that works is because it taps into the flow dynamic as well. So the dog perceives flow and relating to the human. And as long as the dog feels in the flow, it's not possible to be either disobedient or problematic. So my complaint against the other systems is that they don't 100% articulate a flow language to describe to the market, this is why things work in the animal's mind. So if we do, if we were to connect with our dog 100% through this concept of flow, then you can have kids over. And I mean, I didn't introduce children to my shepherds until they were 2 years of age. And they were fine with kids. They loved the kids because they perceive the children as, wow, one more flow entity that's going to be fun.
Wow.
Hmm.
Have you ever worked with like Rottweilers and pit bulls around kids and things?
Oh, sure. Yep. So work a lot with that. And it's, again, it's the same thing. If the dog, and this isn't a matter of the breed per se, but if the dog perceives the child as an interruption of attention of the owner, then he gets defensive. And if we look at in the wild, we see wolves, and they're very instinctive, and they're very worried about survival. So when they see another wolf that's not of their pack on the horizon, they get very defensive.
Mm.
So if you have this pack mentality with your dog, then they don't respond well to change, because that's what the pack instincts are for, to be defensive when things change too much. That's what caused me to question the pack model, that it really wasn't therapeutic. It wasn't healthy for there to be this power structure.
Yeah, so talk a little bit about that pack model, because that's the sort of predominant main model that's being taught out there, isn't it?
Yes, well, there's two models now. There's the pack model, which is the old school Caesar Millan, and my father could very well have been the first one to articulate it in the late 40s,
okay,
when he became a dog trainer, commercial dog trainer. And then there's this new concept of a wolf pack as an extended family group, and it's more a parent-family kind of relationship. And in my mind, both of those miss the mark, and the dominant one misses the mark very widely, because it posits that dogs are interested in social status, and they're interested in rank,
mm-hmm,
and they're studying everything in terms of rank. In other words, it's us versus them. And that pits us into a test of wills, which isn't helpful.
And then the alpha male, too, right?
Pardon?
And then the alpha male, too.
Yeah, that there's an alpha male or an alpha leader.
Uh-huh.
And one way I like to pose, you know, we can all do this little thought experiment. As a matter of fact, it's been verified through field research. But if the prey were to go left and the alpha were to go right, which way would the pack go? And the answer, as I say, it's been actually noticed in the wild, the pack would go left. They would follow the prey. So what caused me to question this idea of a human psychological construct of social life was it just didn't add up. And I would have a little dog that would, quote-unquote, dominate a big dog. If anyone lives with a big and little dog, it's a little dog that ends up so-called superior.
Oh, yeah, always.
Or it's a female dog that dominates, quote-unquote, the male dog.
Uh-huh.
And then the biggest paradox is, in any mixed household of animals, a cat will always control a dog.
Yeah, cats always do, don't they?
Exactly. So yeah. What I came to recognize in the 70s was that the prey actually controls, if that's a word we need to use, the pack. The prey is the organizing principle. So whatever prey any given predator evolved to hunt, his social structure will be predicated on hunting that prey. In other words, the hunt, and this is what I articulate in natural dog training, the hunt creates the group or the pack, the social, not the other way around. See, up till now, the thinking now is that you create this social structure and then you're able to work as a team. That was my father's theory.
And get what you want, right?
Yeah, and I discovered it was the opposite, that if you and your dog are working toward a common object, a common goal, that neither of you could get on your own, that was the genesis of social life.
So how do they even set up an alpha male? Is there a leader there?
No, there's one. Yeah, I like to call it a hierarchy of feelings. So whoever wants something the most goes first. The rest are happy to follow.
Oh.
So if we look at any group, through circumstances, one is a little bit older than the others or stronger, and this one will want the prey more than the other ones, and they follow him. But, you know, a year or two goes by and he loses a step, he loses some virility, some dynamic lust for the prey,
mm-hmm,
he's no longer the leader. The example I like to give is a football team. The quarterback is invariably the leader, not because he's the most dominant, and many times they're not even a bold personality. The quarterback for Seattle is very soft-spoken. Mm-hmm. And out here in giant country, Eli Manning is very soft, and yet he won two Super Bowls. So whoever puts the ball in the end zone is the leader. Let me put it that way.
Okay, so it's not necessarily...
That's why the quarterback is always the leader on a football team, because he's the one most responsible for putting the ball in the end zone. And as soon as he can't do it, he's out.
So it's not necessarily...
What we gotta learn is what constitutes scoring a touchdown from the Dawes' point of view.
So they don't really care as much about control and domination and things like that. It's more about respect and that
actually,
kind of thing.
Well, I like to say that in the animal mind, there's no such thing as control or respect either. There's fear and there's trust. That's
fear
it.
And trust. Wow.
Yep. So if they trust you, then it looks like respect, but they actually, and this brought me to your dog is your mirror. A dog will actually merge its mind with your mind. It doesn't think of itself or feel of itself as separate from whoever it's emotionally bonded with. So when we're looking at a group of wolves, what I started to recognize was, wow, I was looking at one mind. They were all aligned of one mind relative to wanting that prey. They all trusted each other to want that same thing. And that's how they lived. That's how they overcame a prey. And, you know, wolves evolved to hunt a really dangerous prey, buffalo, muskox, moose.
Mm-hmm.
And in terms of physical superiority, I don't think there's a predator who's that outmatched by its prey. I think the canine is the number one disparity between prey and predator. And the only way they have success is to have this emotional rapport amongst themselves, to have this teamwork.
Wow.
And that's what allows them to live in harmony otherwise, not the other way around.
That's so interesting. We're with Kevin Behan, and his website is naturaldogtraining.com. And I just had a quick question for you. We're going to take a little break here, but maybe after the break we can get to this. So I was just curious, you know, most dogs are domesticated these days and don't get a chance to hunt and that kind of thing. So I'm curious if that somehow diminishes from their evolutionary biology somehow. Maybe future generations are going to be more domesticated or something like that. So curious, because our little 10-pound wiener dog is not hunting anything. But so we'll talk about that after the break. We're with, again, Kevin Behan, Natural Dog Training, and we'll be right back.
I have to say, I have been absolutely loving this product by Tristan Truscott and Peter Ragnar called Good Morning, Good Evening, Qigong. If you want to listen to the interview we did with Tristan, you can go to extremehealthradio.com/127. And Qigong is a great way to de-stress the body. And as you know, there's a huge component to disease caused by stress. And stress is a huge factor in how we live our lives and the amount of energy we have and the amount of vitality we have. And so, Dr. Shade, what do you think about Qigong?
People come to me and they're really sick and they got this blown out neurological system and all this toxicity. And I tell them, you need to do Qigong Tai Chi. You need to do these things that settle down and restore your neurology, because it puts together all the parts. It puts you back into that state where you can start to detoxify. And so I highly, highly recommend all that.
And what about you, Kit Campbell? What do you think about Qigong? Do you like it as well?
Qigong is amazing. And the reason that I believe it to be amazing is everything here is energy. That is a scientific fact, if there ever is one. So when you're practicing Qigong, you're actually drawing energy into your body. Your intention, whatever your intention is behind any action, will determine the level of energy, type of energy that you absorb into your body. So your intention behind your is very important, just like thought. So when you're practicing Qigong, you're actually bringing energy in and you're bringing out the stuff that might be a bit stale. With Tai Chi, it's totally different. The energy runs underneath the skin because it's more of a martial, this is the Chinese understanding, by the way. It's more of a martial art. So Qigong is very, very good for bringing that energy into the body, and just fantastic.
If you're interested in picking up this Qigong course by Tristan Truscott and Peter Ragnar, go to extremehealthradio.com/Qigong. That's Qigong. And you can learn more about it. There's a great video on that page, and you can learn more about it on that page. And I highly, highly recommend this product. I love it myself. So go ahead and check that out. extremehealthradio.com/Qigong.
100% listener supported. Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Don't forget to join our thriving community for health tips, inspiration, and show updates at extremehealthradio.com/Facebook.
Okay, we still have not figured out what this guy's talking about, have we?
What he's singing about? What's he going on about?
Yeah, not Kevin Behan, but the singer here. I'm not sure what the heck he's on about.
Yeah, you know, I sometimes have this in my head, this song, and I'll be like, I don't even know. I get just watermelon. You know, you just, I don't know what he's saying.
What an interesting guy.
It's bizarre.
Yeah, this singer is really interesting.
We'll figure it out one day what he's talking about.
So if you guys have any questions about that Qigong program, feel free to email me, let me know. I'd love to help you out if you are thinking about ordering that and want some more information about it. Tristan Truscott's an amazing guy. Truscott, I should say.
Truscott.
And don't forget to join us on Facebook and keep up to date with all of our shows, our past archives, upcoming shows. We do shows 4 days a week. So follow us on Facebook and keep up to date with everything we have going on. We'd love to have you a part of the community there. And so before the break, we were talking a little bit about just kind of how the whole thing goes with the emotional side with animals. And Kate, I know you wanted to bring something up about Maggie, our little wiener dog. But I'm just curious, Kevin, with these animals and the fact that they're so highly domesticated these days, do you think there's any detrimental aspects to the fact that they are unable to hunt in packs and things like that?
Not if we understand their nature. And let me put it this way. Another understanding that followed from my looking at the dog in this new way was that domestication isn't a process of taming the wolf, of making the wolf. I never agreed that it had to do with docility, submissiveness, cognitive comprehension of human ways. It's actually, it's an emotional connection. And at the deepest level, it works according to energy. And it's the wildest thing about us and about any animal as well is emotion. Emotion in us is not tameable. It's not trainable. It's not conditionable. It is a raw, it's like a river that runs through us, and it's got its own force that we will subscribe to or else. So what connects man to dog is emotional, and hunting was how it happened way back 80,000 years ago. But it's an emotional rapport according to certain principles. And for example, that happens when you take your dog for a car ride. Dogs love car rides, because everybody's facing in the same direction and their bodies are swaying and lurching and yawing and pitching exactly the same resonance. It articulates the principles of energy that are the very deepest thing we can say about emotion.
Right.
I'm sorry.
Right.
Oh, shoot. Are you there?
Yep.
Oh, thought we lost you. Sorry.
Oh, sorry.
No.
So it's a situation when dogs are in the car and traveling like that. They're all... the whole family is working in a unit, in a group, towards a common goal. And that's really what the hunt is designed to do as well, right?
Exactly. I mean, you can't take your cat to the park for a frisbee catch. But you can take your dog, because for a dog, emotionally, that's the same as hunting.
Okay.
And hunting doesn't have anything to do with the material reward. It's the flow of it that they want. That's all they want, is the flow. And obviously, in the wild, you're going to starve to death if you don't get some material thing. But guess what? That's how nature works anyhow. So when they flow together, they end up with stuff to eat.
That's so interesting.
But they're not actually doing it to get something to eat. It really starts to open a window into the animal mind once we get past the human concepts. But just to make sure that I was clear about it, we couldn't domesticate anything that didn't have an emotional nature to it. We amplified what was wild about the wolf. We didn't tame it. That's what happened. The opposite of the way we would think of it intellectually. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. And that is counterintuitive. Yeah, I guess you'd say. Kevin, we have a question about this. This comes up a lot with people in our lives, and especially in our own situation with our little dog, Maggie. But the difference between trusting maybe a whole family and being emotionally bonded with maybe one family member more than another. Is that what's happening when the dog seems to really have a connection with one person more than anyone else in the family?
Yeah, that can have two different manifestations. Each mm-hmm. would have a little different quality, or actually a substantially different quality. Mm-hmm. If you have two people and one dog, you'll find that one person aligns with the dog and the other person identifies with the dog.
Hmm.
Conversely, from the other side of the thing, the dog will see one person more in terms of the flow dynamic and the other one more in terms of the charge.
Okay.
So it might be more attached or dependent on one, but the other is more the flow.
Does that have anything to do with the person, like in our case where I was the one by myself to drive an hour and a half and pick up our dog and bring her home, and she's more connected to me, it seems like, emotionally.
Maybe because you're female, too.
I don't know, yeah. What is that? I wonder what that's about.
It's kind of hard to know on the surface, but let me just put it this way. If some guy owns a hunting hound and is tied to the backyard doghouse, and he doesn't have anything to do with it, but his nice, kindly wife is always bringing it in when it's rainy and cold and feeds it every day, mm-hmm. but he takes it hunting once a year. Who is that dog living for?
Mm.
Right? So yeah. The flow dynamic. But it'll be very attached to the woman, to the wife. But usually what I see is that someone is really, like if I work with a couple and the dog has a problem, typically, the man will minimize the problem. He's aligned with the flow. Yeah, it's not so bad, and the wife will be more attached to the problem.
Mm. Uh-huh. Yeah.
By the way, do you help people, or do you mainly just write books and things like that? Can you help people if they call you, or how does that work?
Oh, yeah. Yep, that's basically what I do, is work with people and their dogs.
Okay.
I tried building an ivory tower, but I couldn't stay up there. I didn't come out of it. So.
That's funny. So there's this real deep connection between the emotional nature of what animals want, who they connect with, and what they're doing, and us. And in your book called Your Dog is Your Mirror, you talk a lot about that. And you really talk about how the animals understand what's going on sort of in our lives too, don't they?
Yeah, they read us, as I might have I mentioned somehow in the book, the animal in them reads the animal in us. If you ever watch two dogs get together, it's really amazing. They, I work with problem dogs, and I'll be holding a dog, and they'll walk up and just start, I mean, they can see from 100 yards, but once in a while they just come up, and they just get a little smell, and they have it. They turn away like, oh my God, I don't want to touch that with a 10-foot pole. Because they can feel all that charge that's in there. So our dogs are like an emotional sonogram, and they watch us, the way we move. Everything we do is a signature of our own emotional makeup and life history. And it's playing out animalistically, if you will, not intellectually. So they pick up how much force we put in a movement, if we're holding back, if we're overdoing it, the cant, our step, the weight of our step, how we align our spine on our body, the body symmetry. And again, if you go back to the evolution from the wolf, that's what the wolf is doing to see which prey he has a shot at. He's looking for the prey that's a little off kilter, a little vulnerable. So the idea of being really attracted to vulnerability is a big part of the canine makeup. They read us, and they can feel where we're vulnerable, which makes them drawn to us. I mean, we hear about animals all the time. There's that cat in a nursing home that would go to people before they died, and they could tell who was about to pass a day or so ahead of time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because I think the animal, when we're ill like that, all our ego, our barriers come down, and the animal can connect with us much more intimately than when our personality is in full gear and our ego is up to speed and we're putting out all our vibe. Well, that's a little barrier between the animal and the human. So the dog wants to connect with our core, but that's what he's reading. He's reading our body language about our core. And in the words that we speak, everything is an emanation from there.
Dogs
definitely picks up.
Yeah, dogs really are really just an amazing creatures, because I've heard stories of how they, like in the tsunami down in Phuket, Thailand, they, you know, a lot of the animals, the wild animals as well as the dogs, somehow had this instinct that there is a tidal wave coming. And I've even heard stories of dogs being able to see ghosts in the house. I mean, they have some sense of of being able to pick up all this extra energy that we're, like you said, because of our ego and our personality, we just don't seem to be able to connect.
Yeah, we gloss. You're right. We gloss right over it. Now, there is, in my view, emotion is energy, as is consciousness, but emotion connects us with nature and integrates us with all of nature's life forces. So, whatever you can say about emotion and whatever you can say about energy, you can say about emotion. So, we are very highly calibrated instruments. We can pick up a lot more than we know. Mm-hmm. If we live very naturally, I mean, indigenous people have just most amazing capacities, just like the dogs. And I remember that same tsunami. There were some indigenous fishermen on the water, and they're native boats, and they're next to some Thai fishermen with a big commercial boat.
Mm-hmm.
And they said that the color of the water's wrong. It looks wrong. We should get out of here. And they laughed at these indigenous fishermen and said, what crazy story is that? Sure enough,
wow.
4 hours later came the wave that wiped everybody out, but they were long gone.
That's crazy. Yeah, when people get more in touch with their own nature and nature itself of the earth and things, it's really interesting. I was wondering what you were saying a few minutes ago when you're talking about how the dog connects with us. And I was thinking about, you know, how many people will talk about when they get pregnant and they have a child, and whatever bad behaviors, quote unquote bad behaviors, that child is exhibiting, whether it's a baby crying or whatever, it always seems to be about the mother and the father, and the baby simply is just, you know, pushing the buttons that the emotional problems that the parents have, and they're just sort of making those problems more well known to the parents. And so dogs are doing the same kind of thing, aren't they?
Yes, exactly. That's exactly right. Everything is a mirror. So the dog will reflect. I mean, it's just amazing to watch your dog and see the little things they do, and then just try to link it to something. And you get very good. It's almost like dream interpretation. First you have a dream, it just seems nonsensical, but if you just sit with it and explore how you feel by those various scenes, this whole universe of meaning will come out of it. And so if you just watch your dog do little things, and then just wait for the recognition to arise. Some part of you gets it instantly, but our minds are very busy and very brilliant and displace this much more subtle input that we're getting from our bodies. And so if you just sit with it, the way I learned my ideas and model and method was just to see something wasn't making sense, something was off, I didn't know what it was, so I just put it out that I want to know what it is, and I just waited. And little by little, you get the information comes in. So that's a really good mindful exercise, is to study the dog and see something. It'll catch your eye. Something will be very interesting, or maybe something will be irritating. It doesn't matter. Anything that really has a little charge to it, you want to study it and ponder it. And there have been instances where when those correlations were made, the dog's behavior went away.
Mm. Wow. That's crazy.
Now we're aware of it.
Do you think it's possible for people? I've heard people talk about being able to communicate with their dogs and psychic weird stuff. Do you think that's possible?
You know, I have personal testimony with medical intuitives, so I think it's possible. But you know, when I hear the animal communicators, it's just like they're putting human thoughts into the mind of the animal that doesn't resonate for me.
Mm-hmm.
And then I also think, I don't think you could, why do we have to even have dog trainers? Why can't we communicate, don't run away, you'll get hit by a car, or stop biting, or we'll have to put you down, you know?
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So I think the problem I have with that isn't that I discount it altogether. As a matter of fact, the animal communicators could be picking up the thoughts of the human that's in the relationship and that is affecting the dog, so that might be how it would be therapeutic. But I think the thing with a dog, though, is we're meant to get down in the muck and mire of emotion and not approach it from a telepathic, high-level spiritual manner of engagement. We're meant to get down into the our emotional basement and figure out that plumbing and do the penance with the dog that we have, rather than get all lofty and rise above it and communicate these human-like thoughts to the dog to solve problems. I really think that's almost not honoring the emotional process that we could be going through when we're living with a dog.
Yeah, it's so interesting. In the past, I've seen dogs and their connections to people are so amazing. I don't know if you've seen this, Kevin, where there is a story recently where a service veteran passed away and they had a funeral and and the dog just would not leave the casket,
or sit by the stone of the cemetery for months. Just heart-wrenching.
It's heart-rending, but it really does show the depth of the connection. And there's stories of a dog at the subway station in Japan waiting every day for his owner to come home after he died. Just every day for the rest of the dog's life. And then there's the famous dog that took vigil over his master's grave in a church in England. And when they couldn't dislodge it, so they built him a house, they set him there, and he lived his days over his master's grave. So,
oh, my goodness.
It's an amazing connection, that's for sure.
Yeah, they say people that have dogs live longer. So, Kevin, you might be outliving all of us here.
All right, good.
We're going to take a little break. We're with Kevin Behan, and his website is naturaldogtraining.com. And we're going to get into maybe some more specifics. So, maybe how to tell your dog to come or sit and heal, those kinds of things. Perhaps maybe
stop
in the next...
Stop barking at people.
Or stop barking. That's one of Maggie's problems. We'll see if we can get to the bottom of that issue. So again, his website is naturaldogtraining.com. Really, really fascinating guy. And I would highly recommend, if you do have a dog and you want an alternative way of looking at why they're behaving the way they're behaving and some things you can do, give them a call. Go on to naturaldogtraining.com, check them out, and I think he can help you out. So we're going to be right back right after this break. The history of heat therapy dates back over 2,400 years, and it was Hippocrates who said, "Give me the power to produce fever, and I will cure all disease." This FDA-approved medical device called the Biomat is a mat that you can lay on, read on, sleep on, do yoga on, sit on, and it can be used on office chairs, massage tables, and the like to help the body heal itself. It's inlaid with 30 pounds of healing crystals using amethyst and a rare black tourmaline, producing negative ions in a healing electrical field. These healing crystals help to restore cellular health by replacing electrons to the atoms, as well as penetrating deep into the body by 4 to 6 inches. What can the Biomat do for you? It'll improve your skin, burns as many calories as if you went jogging for 30 minutes. It improves the immune system by up to 40% or more, reduces stress and fatigue, removes toxins, lowers cholesterol, relieves pain, revitalizes cellular metabolism. It improves cell channels to deliver nutrients and oxygen to every one of your cells. It activates over 3,000 enzymes. And even a Harvard medical study showed cancer cells die at over 42 degrees Celsius. It reduces stress hormones by up to 78%. It allows your body to produce heat shock proteins, which increases endorphins, NK cells, T cells, and lymphocytes. It's very, very low EMF, and it's got a 17-layer technology. Dr. Mark Serkis is the director of the International Medical Veritas Association. Explain to us more about these biomats.
These biomats are these far infrared mattresses. You lay on them, or you sleep on them, or both. You do very heavy treatments during the day, and at night you sleep at just a nice comfortable temperature. These biomats are like these love machines, comfort machines, and healing machines, because what they do is they just radiate out light far infrared light, and you can radiate yourself all night long while you're sleeping when you're not doing anything else. And what happens is this light penetrates the body and turns to heat. And the first thing that happens when you bring your core body temperature up 1 degree is your immune system strength increases by 40-50%. They feel when you lay down on them, you know, you guys know, you have one. So it's like the feeling is so good. It's like being in the cuddling with a lover, your wife or husband. It's just warmth and comfort.
How are you using biomats for patients in your clinics?
You know, the cancer treatment using heat is very aggressive, meaning during the day, you sandwich yourself in between two of them, turn it on to high heat, and bake the cancer. The cancer will die before you will. No, this is, you know,
that's
you can
awesome.
Go to England and spend $20,000 and use microwave a cancer out of existence. These biomats basically do the same thing. You know, radiation therapy for cancer is really a solid idea. Unfortunately, oncologists use the wrong radiation. They use radiation that kills you. This biomat uses radiation that can save your life and make your life more comfortable, keep you warm in the cold, and help take care of your kids and all, you know, the list doesn't end.
Yeah, because isn't there some sort of temperature at which cancer cells will start dying?
Right, and it's below the temperature that human cells will die.
So you really like this biomat far infrared technology, don't you?
But it's really strengthened me. Well, now the kids are addicted to it. You know, they fight on who's going to sleep on it at night. And it changed, not only changed my life, but it changed my medical practice and my books. This is a great machine for anybody who lives in the cold during the winter. Instead of heating a big house, you just heat yourself. What, bottom line, it brings good feelings. Just lay on this biomat and it gives the strength back.
I can attest to that indeed. Kate and I love ours and we think you will too. Learn more about these amazing biomats at extremehealthradio.com/biomat. Or you could check them out in our store as well. Again, that's extremehealthradio.com/biomat.
Free shows all the time on Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Join our community today. Sign up to our email list and instantly get our free gift to you, along with loads of inspirational content and cutting-edge tips to help change your life at extremehealthradio.com/subscribe.
Well, I feel like we could talk all day about this subject. Isn't this just fascinating?
This is fascinating. I know people are just resonating. I mean, most people I know have a dog or love dogs or have so many questions that I'm sure we could fill up 4 hours and not even touch on.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. And I love the fact that Kevin's taking a unique approach. It's almost sort of like natural childbirth or unique ways of parenting that don't take this traditional standard model of power and domination and force and really looks at everything from the other perspective. I just think it's so good.
I tend to be drawn toward anything that seemed, quote, opposite of what we're normally
told. I know. I agree. So if you guys have any questions about that biomat, it's a substantial investment, but one that we love. And in fact, our little 10-pound wiener dog right now is actually asleep on it, snoring on it during the show. So she loves it. So if you have any questions about that, please let me know. Love to help you out. And don't forget to sign up to our newsletter list. We've given away a free ebook that sells for $20 on Amazon called Lessons from the Miracle Doctors. Great, great stuff. So stay up to date that way with everything we have going on, if you would. That would be amazing. And Kevin, I just had a little question for you here in terms of our particular situation. It seems as if in the recent years, we have become more and more disenchanted with where we're living as we're getting a little bit more frustrated with the amount of noise that we are living near. We live in a little beach community and it's very, very noisy. And it seems as if our dog, our little dachshund, when we first moved in, was able to sort of look out the window. We live higher up off the ground and it seems as if she was able to just sort of look around and be okay with the noise.
Enjoy the cars, the people walking by.
And as we've been getting a little bit more and more frustrated because of the construction and things going on around our house, we've been getting more disenchanted with the noise. And it seems like that is going along with our dog. She barks more at other animals walking by and things. Is that a case of your dog is your mirror?
Yeah, exactly. As you get more charged by these things, and, you know, you may not even notice that you're getting charged, but you hear a sound or something that's becoming more and more repetitive. So you're building up a charge, and your dog will seek to relieve that charge by its behavior.
That's so interesting.
Rationally, so it'll do it physically.
Yeah, it's wild, because you've talked about that a lot, the charge, and the charge is sort of like this energy that you put out that you don't even know you put out, and either your dog can put it out or you can, I think, and the dog will look to release that charge so that it sort of mitigates the energy and brings back the flow, right?
Yeah, and I think that technically, physically, how it would manifest is our viscera actually constricts, it gets tight, mm-hmm. and we won't feel that, but it, you know, rather than its normal peristaltic smooth action, it'll cue up and it'll get tight. I think the dog can discern that in us, and it would change our many, many things about us. There's a whole system based on this feeling of internal flow or not, the constriction. So that's how I think they gradually pick up the charge, that they notice, they feel a tension in our body that we may not even be aware of because it's our absolute deepest part of our makeup.
Right. So obviously it's an interesting situation. In our situation, we just naturally want to get upset with her and stop barking. And, you know, she's trying to sort of offload some of our stress that we didn't even know we had. And yet our response to her is complete opposite probably of how it should be, correct?
Yeah, your irritation at the people you're going to take out on her mm-hmm. because she's expressing your irritation to the people. So that would be the instinctive cycle.
So it's not necessarily even the fact that she's territorial and wants to protect us. It's more she just wants to dissipate that charge.
Exactly. It has nothing to do with that, exactly. So, but let's just imagine you're a xenophobic nomad with your hound dog, and it barks at other nomads. Well, that would protect you.
Right.
So, but it's still coming from that emotion. I mean, we can't do it with cats. We can't do it with any other animal but the dog, that kind of service and utility. So it's not enough to say, well, they did it, therefore we threw them a steak bone. I mean, you can't do it with anything but the dog because that's the level at which they interface with us. So I'll tell you a quick story like that. We moved from our commercial kennel to a nice residential area, from an industrial sector to a nice house where the little kids could play in the yard. And my neighbors, who I didn't know at the time, they had a dog that would come over to my yard and poop. And he'd poop in my driveway, and he'd step in it. He'd step in it and get in your car, and, oh, my God, the floor mat is destroyed. You walk in the house, and you wouldn't notice it till you're in the house. And I was so mad, and I was so mad at that dog. And I was in, this is in the early, sometime in the 80s, mid-80s, and I was going to, I knew my theory said it's an indirect way of trying to connect with me. But my instinct said, get the dog, and I was going to devise all these Rube Goldberg methods of correcting her when she's in my property, but she wouldn't associate it with me. And then one day, before I had gotten in the workshop to concoct this thing, I'm in my three little perfect little cherub babies are in the back seat of the wagon, and they see Buttons, her name was, on the side, on the hill. They said, oh, that bad Buttons. I hate Buttons. And, oh, I winced. I said, oh, my God, what have I transferred to my kids? So I said, no, kids, Buttons is okay. I like Buttons. So I got out and started playing with Buttons. I got out with the kids. We started throwing a stick with Buttons and playing with Buttons. So I finally took the practical application of my theoretical understanding and connected with her through play, directly, right there in the road, and loved her up every time I saw her. And you know what? 90.9999, she never pooped in my driveway yard again.
Oh,
so what
God.
Do you think she was doing? I wonder, like, on a deeper level, she was doing that to bring, maybe she really wanted you to be friends with her, and that's why she...
Well, yeah, exactly. She couldn't connect with me directly. I was a big, scary dog guy, and I didn't even know I was putting out that kind of aura.
Uh-huh.
So when I wasn't around, she'd go over and eliminate. And that is, the reason dogs are lifting their legs isn't to establish rank or territory. It's an indirect way of greeting another. So, for example, when we meet our fellow human, we reflexively talk about the weather. We take it off each other, and we put it on the weather.
Uh-huh.
And then we say, yeah, it's hot, cold, rainy, windy. And now we know we can resonate with that person. So dogs lift their legs as an indirect way of connecting, and if the other dog responds, then they can resonate with each other, and that's how they introduce themselves. So she was going to my property when I wasn't there because that's the only time she felt safe to connect with me.
Wow.
Indirect. So I finally had to do the math. I said, oops, that's what I should have paid attention to from the beginning. The cool thing was to start playing, the kids started liking, we all started loving buttons, and that was the end of the problem, really and truly. It would maybe once in a while, I think maybe the owners would yell at her and she might do it, but it was so rare, I mean, we forgot about it.
Aww.
So with your dog, what you've got to do is to teach her to bark at you instead of at them.
Like, you mean perhaps when she might bark when we want to play, throw the ball with her and things?
Or if she's frustrated.
Well, yeah, what you do is, you got to do it in an organized way, is you show her something she wants, and I take food, I clasp it to my chest, and then I encourage him to get it, and they'll jump up and they'll scratch at you to get it, and if you just hold it there and you say, come on, speak, and just sweetie pie talk to them, eventually they'll sit, they'll lick their lips, you can give them a cookie for that, but little by little, you'll nurse a bark out of them, and you'll notice that if she is really good at barking to the horizon, she'll be very bad at barking to you. It'll be hard for her to give you this deep energy, because that bark is the breath, and it comes from a very deep, the deepest part of the dog's mind is where it comes from. So her mind is focused on these outsiders. So you want to get her focused on you and get her to bark at you. And once you can do that, you can then tell her very calmly, hey, no, don't bark at those people. Those people are okay. It's all part of the flow here.
Oh, okay. So there's a sort of a three-pronged approach from what you were saying earlier. One is, if your dog's barking a lot at certain situations that you're living in. In our case, it's the noise around us. So in our case, it's to work on ourselves and to work on not being so upset at the noise. That's number one. Number two would be doing what you were just talking about, perhaps when they're not actually barking, sort of training them when they're behaving well. And then the third thing, what would you do during an episode of when they're actually going crazy barking at something?
Oh, I put them on the leash. I show them the food. Matter of fact, you can only feed her during these situations, so you'll have some motivation for you. And I wouldn't tell her not to bark. I'd tell her how to bark. Bark at me. Don't bark at them. Because you're really the problem, because you don't want to be there, and she's got to be where you are, so better bark at you.
That's true.
And then you want to look at the irritation factors. So you're there year-round, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, so you're going to have a natural antipathy toward interlopers, people who are, they're just coming around during the tourist season, and those are the brassier ones and noisier ones. So you want to, we have that in Vermont, a lot of people don't like the skiers coming.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, I'd love to, and sometimes you go down to your market and you can't do anything because there's so many skiers. But, I mean, it's just such a wonderful thing. I just get into how cool is it somebody, Vermont makes money by people coming up and going down a snow hill, you know?
Yeah, it's crazy.
I look for the flow of it. So I would look for the flow in these people coming to the beach and softening, and it supports all the various beach activities and mm-hmm. bistros or whatever, and I would look for the flow in it, and then that flow will carry you to wherever you're going to go anyhow. But from the dog's point of view, teach her to bark at you.
Mm-hmm. So do you think it's during one of those episodes, it's a bad thing to say your dog's, I'm suspecting the answer is yes, but saying your dog's name in a negative tone, like if we said Maggie, no, I suspect that would not be a good thing. Is that what you
think? If you don't have a foundation, all you do is drive it deeper, and that actually lowers the dog's triggering threshold. And you're also teaching her she can't give you that energy.
Okay.
He can't give you stranger energy, so you're actually teaching her not to trust you when there's strangers around. And I know the linkage sounds kind of out far strong, but that's actually what she's learning. But if you want to be the ground to that stranger energy, you want to be who she gives it to. So if you had a child that was making trouble in school, you'd want them to come to you and say, geez, Mommy, Daddy, I was thinking of smacking Johnny.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't say, bad Billy. You'd say, oh, Billy, thanks for sharing. You know, I'll tell you what, why don't, will you always tell me when you feel like smacking Johnny? Yep. Okay, so first you would encourage the child to give you that energy. What are you feeling? What's up? What's the matter with you? You'd want them to give it to you. So that's why you got to look at it with a dog, is give you that energy. So when I work with aggressive dogs, I don't tell them not to be aggressive. I attract it. Hmm. I have them give it to me. And I channel it into a safe expression. And then I love the dog up while he's doing it, and now the dog's starting to trust me. He can trust me, he can trust everybody.
I love that whole way of looking at it, because it's almost as if, like, if you're in a situation where it's really awkward and you're talking with one or two people, and it's just really awkward. Maybe you're with your wife and you have an ex-girlfriend there or something like that. And it's almost like a... like the dog is just looking, she's like that comedic friend in the background, just trying to make sure everyone is nice and happy and there's no contention. And that's what dogs are really trying to do with this charge that you're talking about, isn't it?
Yeah. To them, a charge is stuck energy, and their entire scope of life is to move stuck energy.
So they like to work. Right.
They like to work. That's why you see a dog with a toy, and he's got the toy, so what does he do? He drops it into a hard-to-reach place.
I know. Our dog always does that.
Yeah, so he can work and fight this toy. He needs to overcome resistance. Things have to get stuck, and he can get them going again.
Oh, wow.
So they're picking up what's stuck in us, and this becomes what they got to get going, because how are they going to have a team if somebody holds back?
That's
if you
right.
walk into a room and somebody's holding back, you start to get suspicious. What's wrong with them?
Yeah. Forget going to a psychologist. Just get a dog.
Well, the working title of the book was Your Dog is Your Best Therapist. I think that's what it was.
Wow, it's true, though.
So true.
So when you really look at the dogs and you can really see, and you really start looking at your own life, they really do become a mirror, and they're showing you all kinds of things.
It's an act of total humility, let me tell you.
Hmm. Wow. So do you think it's bad to get, I know a lot of dogs are getting neutered these days. We have our little dachshund, she's not spayed or neutered or anything. Do you think there's detriment?
Yeah, I think I don't recommend neutering. I can appreciate spaying if it's from the convenience point of view.
Uh-huh.
You got to be much more careful with a whole female. The later, the better. But certainly health-wise, whole equals health. There's no, the language is the language. So I've never been for the neutering and the early spaying.
Mm-hmm.
Never have I been for that. I just have to have someone who's willing to train the dog's energy. But we get all these health problems because the dogs are neutered and spayed way too early.
Oh, yeah. I can imagine.
Along with that probably comes some hormonal shifts that they hold on to, but I'm sure even with time and treating that properly, you can kind of
mitigate that.
Well, yeah. But if you look at what makes the dog, they're the most social and sexual animal on earth.
Hmm.
And the social and the sexual go together. It's not antithetical. So we got a dog marketplace that says that sexual hormones are antithetical to sociability. And yet, incongruently, the behaviorists look at the bonobo, which is the social ape, and it's super sexual, and the chimp, which is super aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
And they say we should be more like bonobos than chimps. But when it comes to the dog, they say the opposite. They contradict themselves. So, yeah, sexuality is part of maturation.
Yeah, they told us when we got our dachshund here that they said that if we did not spay her, she would be more aggressive and she would run after cars and things like that and barking at people on skateboards and thing. And that seems to be true, but I mean, as annoying as it is, and for us to, we're going to work on her discharging that energy, but as annoying as that is, it's natural, right?
Yeah, but it shouldn't cause, a dog is healthiest and happiest if he fits seamlessly in your life and isn't having to move stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that's causing friction. So I don't ever worry about denying a dog these natural activities, because I give him what he needs anyhow. I give him the thing I want him to bite, and the bark, and the push, and I give him all the stuff that is natural he gets through me. So he's not missing out on anything. But when you keep a dog, keeping a dog whole doesn't train him. It just makes him stronger. It gives him more energy. Mm-hmm. That's why it got a bad rap, because whole males had more energy. So if you don't raise them and train them right, you're going to have more of a problem.
Mm.
But neutering them isn't training them either. It's just giving them less energy, which is why they're not as healthful.
Mm.
So interesting.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
No, so it'll actually be easier to recapture your dog because she's whole.
That makes sense. Yeah, it makes sense, because there's no missing parts there, and
yeah,
in turn, shifting hormones and things like that.
Right. Well, you know, you're probably familiar with Candace Pert's book, Molecules of Emotion, and she discovered that the immune system and the endocrine system and the nervous system form she called it a psychosomatic network, and it's the most vital part of the mind and body. So once we disable the endocrine system, that's taking a big chunk out of it. That's not good for the whole network. So,
yeah
it's on all levels, it's good to keep them whole, but you have to channel that energy.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not on a mission to tell everybody don't neuter, don't spay, but I'm on a mission to say, well, don't make me neuter or spay if I am responsible.
Right.
You know? Mm-hmm. So if you're willing to do the work and you have a good life for your dog, and you care about her, and you're taking care of her, and you're not letting her get into trouble, and you can keep her whole, and you can manage it, and you'll have more energy to work with.
It's so interesting. When we take our dog out, we do this little thing with her. It's pretty cute. We'll, Kate will have her on a leash, or I'll have her on the leash, and we'll all three of us be walking, and one of us will stop. So let's say Maggie and I will stop and say we're in the park, and Kate will go up about 100 yards or 50 yards and keep walking. And that initial separation that, Maggie and Kate have, as soon as Kate keeps walking and we stop, there tends to be this charge that's built up in Maggie, and I tell her to wait and to stay, and then Kate will go ahead about 50 yards and then call Maggie, and she'll just bolt like lightning. She'll run as fast as she can. Is that a good thing to do, to teach dogs to come, or is that a good way of building that?
Yep, that's excellent. That's how we start police dogs.
That's
how you start search and rescue training. It's just another form of hunting is what that is, and you are the object. So that's how you should, every time we take a dog in the woods when they're young, we're training them and forming them, we play hide and seek for 10 minutes. Then the dog, his tongue is hanging out, and he's happy to walk for an hour. He's done. He's got it out of his system. We're who he should hunt for.
Mm. Wow.
And then we go on our walk. So, you know, that's an excellent thing to do. Very good thing to do.
That's funny. Yeah, and we sort of do the same thing with her food, too. It's funny, when we feed her, there seems to be this situation where she'll come running to us, and, she lets
us
know.
Tell us it's time to eat.
It's time to eat. But then there comes a certain time when, if Kate's making her little dinner at night, and, Maggie's down there kind of begging, kind of waiting, and her eyes are just glued to what Kate's doing on the countertop there.
Yep.
If I try to pet her, I become a block to what she wants, and she gets very territorial. So there comes a time where you're the object of what she wants, but then there, after a certain time, you become a barrier to what she wants too, right?
Yeah, see, now you're running into the flow paradigm. So I can take the bone out of my dog's mouth because it means more flow.
Mm-hmm.
It's just how you start them when they're the imprint you create. But so what you should do in that moment is, get a pocket full of food and walk over to her, and you put her into that pressure. You begin to pressure. You see that it's starting to register in her. And you ask her to speak and get that irritation coherent into a coherent wave of sound, which is therapeutic. And then you're going to love, then she's going to give you these barks. You're going to find you're able to touch her, and then you could be the one to say, okay, now go get your food, and you turn yourself into a flow rather than an interruption of flow.
Oh, interesting.
So whenever you see these problems, if you don't take it personally, and instead find the flow quality to it, or lack of flow quality, you can always come up with the answer.
Yeah, I love it, because it's just the whole idea of looking at your dog as a mirror. It's just so, looking deeper, instead of trying to correct problems that we think are problems, it's really, really much deeper. And so in your book, you go through all the different scenarios where people can look and figure out what's going on with their dogs?
Yeah, it's kind of a primer, really. It's really setting out, it does show what's going on inside the dog's mind, but it's calling for a new understanding of emotion as a universal group energy. And it's true of all animals are attracted to humans, absolutely all animals. Every animal is attracted to every other animal, human, just as every particle of mass is attracted to every other particle of mass. Emotion is organized exactly the same way as the laws of nature. So it's basically, this book is saying that this is a new way of looking at emotion, and in this view, everything dogs do makes sense. All of a sudden, it all makes sense. And that would then open up a new way of training and a new way of understanding and other books I want to put into the mix as well. But I think it's a call for a new paradigm, and the bare bones of it are in that book.
So fascinating. So now your first book that you wrote 20 years ago, The Natural Dog Training, that gets into more behavioral instincts with animals, and then this one is just more gets into the emotional and the why of things, then, I guess.
Right, yeah, it's interesting when I look back on that book. I mean, it's all there as well, but it's much more behavioral, and here's a new emotional model for wolf structure. Mm-hmm. Here's a new emotional model for learning when dog training. But it's all about a very clinical view of emotion and the dog's prey instinct. So that's the kind of language. Well, your dog is your mirror is more cleanly articulating this flow dynamic.
It's interesting, because it really is about us, isn't it? I mean, the dog is just the mirror for us, really.
Right, exactly.
Fascinating.
All animals are. The American Indian, or Native American, as I should say, I guess. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of old school with my nomenclature. But they saw, you've seen, I'm sure, the medicine wheel with the animal totems.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, so whenever they would see an animal, they felt it was Manito, the Great Spirit, bringing them a message, and they would do their shamanistic treatment to, okay, what's the animal telling me? And each animal had its own nature. That was the beginning point. So all the animals are a reflection, and the dog is nature. Everything about nature is embodied in the dog. We think of the dog as something man created and that we change, and nothing could be further from the truth. Why can't we create any other animal to do things that the dog do? We can't. Mm-hmm. If this is all an embodiment of natural principles, and that's what we're supposed to learn from our life with the dog, is seeing how we're all part of one flow system. Uh-huh. And that's what we're supposed to learn, I believe.
This might be a strange question, but do you think people who are adverse to having a dog, or they're so anti-dog, and they'll say, I never wanted a dog, I'll never have a dog, do you think deep down, obviously, there's some emotional thing they see in themselves that they just don't want to have to address?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I do. I think, matter of fact, if you look at the cultures around the world, how they view the dog, you'll see quite an interesting spectrum. What the dog is heart. So how we feel about heart energy will project onto the dog. And it's the same thing would be true people that don't like a cat. I mean, I don't know if everyone, obviously everyone shouldn't own a cat or everyone should own a dog, but to not like the cat means it's a force of nature that we don't trust, something we don't trust about ourselves.
Yeah.
That we see it in a cat.
Yeah. That would make sense.
You can't control a cat, which means you can't control. That's what people don't like.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why a lot of people are very attracted to the dominance model. The reason it will never die, even though the science is refuting it and many things are refuting it, even some of the things Caesar does actually disprove the thesis of a dominant hierarchy.
Wow.
But nobody has the language to articulate that. But at any rate, the very fact that we are attracted to that theory is because we want to control our heart. That's what we're actually trying to do. So people might feel powerless, and then they like to exert power over the dog.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, lack of control.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Yeah. So what kind of stuff are you working on now? Are you working on any new books?
Yep. I'm working on a series of e-books with the actual techniques that go along with the latest philosophy of natural dog training. But I'm working on, I hate to call it a memoir, but it's a whole bunch of dog stories that led me to believe these things.
Oh. From
the beginning and things I experienced with dogs that there was no rational explanation for, so I had to come up with something to account for this. So these are seminal events in my own experience, and I don't like to call it a memoir because it's autobiographical, but there's not a word in it about me.
Hmm.
It's all about flow.
Oh, I see. Wow, and so you also work with people physically in your area, and then if people want to call up over the phone, they can call you as well?
Yep, that's what I do primarily, is work with dogs, and I work with problem dogs and their volatile owners.
Well, I guess the problem is really with the owner, isn't it?
True.
The problem is the volatile owner.
That's true. Wow. Well, thank you so much for your work. And are those e-books, when do you think they're going to be coming out?
I think pretty soon. Just stay tuned to the website. If people would go to naturaldogtraining.com, they'll see the stuff there.
Oh, great. And do you have a Facebook community, and can people sign up to a newsletter on your site too?
Yep.
Oh,
yeah, if they go to the site, they'll see all the little buttons to click, and they can get started.
Oh, that's awesome. That's
great.
Awesome. Perhaps we'll when your ebooks come out, we can talk about those as well, because I really love what you're doing.
Oh, I'd love that. Sure. It'd be my pleasure.
Oh,
excellent.
Great.
Okay, well, we are going to sign off the live show, and so thank you, everybody, so much for joining us. I appreciate it. If you have more questions and more things you want to bring up, you can always jump over to our forum and discuss this interview and what Kevin talked about on our forum. So I want to thank everybody for joining us on the live show. We're going to sign off right now. Thanks so much. Talk soon.
Thank you. Bye.
Well, I bet you didn't know there is so much to dog training as there really is, huh?
I was going to say, it looks like we have some work to do on ourselves.
I know, right?
Man, I feel like we barely scratched the surface. I would love to have him back on after his ebooks come out. And
yeah.
Really, I can't wait to... Gosh, there's so many books I want to read, but I really want to read that book because once you kind of recalibrate in your brain how it actually is supposed to work with dogs and what we're... I mean, I start seeing these things going, oh gosh, like I'm probably way off on this, or this is probably the opposite of what we should be doing, or... just becoming aware, obviously, is the first step, but there's so many things that, you know, obviously you wish you would have done different, but still not too late to. They're highly trainable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. It's wild because, like, you know, when you see your dog barking, your first reaction is just to say, shut up, or be quiet,
stop.
It's really interesting. And as with just about everything we talk about on the show, and there's a lot of, you know, subjects that we haven't even explored on this show, but everything seems to be opposite of what it really is, right?
Man, the more we're finding out, isn't that the truth?
Mm-hmm.
It is.
Yeah.
Well, and I realize in the dog situation, when we do that with Maggie and say, stop, Maggie, and we're just annoyed with her. I mean, of course, her nature is to do it more. She's not going to actually stop. So,
right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Obviously, what we're doing hasn't worked and isn't working. She's super well behaved, but there's moments where she does these things and just acts up. And I think she is kind of gleaning that from our energies and our frustrations. And she's just mirroring.
You know, it'd be amazing. It'd be so cool to do if we could do this, is to pay Kevin to live with us for a couple of days. You know what I mean? And just to see, because everyone's dog is so unique and everyone's dog does unique weird things, and
I know,
you know,
their
I mean?
Little quirks.
They all have different quirks and different things they do. Wouldn't that be cool to have him just live here for a couple of days?
I would love that.
And just really give his insight on every little, you know, thing that Maggie's doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Take.
That'd be so interesting to see.
It would take a couple of days for, I feel like, somebody to pick up on anybody's dog for sure. I mean, there's little things you can't explain day to day that change, you know. That you'd want someone to be around and be like, what the heck's that about? Or
because
I think Maggie, when anybody walks in the house at first, she's not herself for a long time. I mean, it takes a long time for her to really show her little Maggie true colors. But
It's interesting, too, because if you look at what he's doing, it's, I wonder how you could apply that to raising children, because I'm sure there's, you know, a corresponding model for raising children, too.
Oh, I thought about that the whole time he was talking.
Yeah. Because really, you could say the same thing about children. You know, children
are a little mirror of you, too.
Are your mirror, you know?
Yeah.
Sort of like how I brought that situation up on the show where mm-hmm. people have these kids that cry, and really the crying is really activating some deep emotional issue in the parent that needs to get resolved. And so the kid is almost just saying to the parent, hey, you need to resolve this within yourself. And that's the tool of the child, is to do that.
Wow.
Same with the animal too.
Well, I'm starting to think that having children and animals is less about them and more about you. I mean, that's what that's what it is. They're tools, obviously, not to grow, not only to grow as their own person and their own animal and their own emotional entity,
mm-hmm.
but it is definitely about us. What's going on with us? What are we seeing? You know, and even difficult people in our lives. Any of those things that are a challenge.
Imagine having a horrible marriage or something.
Yeah.
You know, fighting all the time. The dog's going to pick up all that. And same with your kid, but the dog will pick up on all that.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
There's more going on than we'll ever know. I mean, we saw a video when we were in the Dominican Republic. Remember that, about that baby growing in the womb? And the parents were having a fight.
Oh yeah.
And as the husband or the males yelled, the baby, actually the fetus, just jumps. They had a monitor on it, and it's like an ultrasound thing, and they show it just reacting. And I mean, it was tiny. It probably had to be like a few months old.
Yeah.
And then thinking, oh gosh, if animals and humans and things are just reacting on this level at such a, I mean, imagine when we come into this world and then we're, you know, kicked around or beat up or hurt or emotionally just, you know, distressed or, that stuff really, it goes deep, and then it becomes embedded in us. And I feel like these are dogs and children are ways to unlock, yeah, what is really going on? How am I, where am I at? It's funny. We didn't think about it till the break with Kevin, that you and I were going, I wonder if it's a reflection of our frustration about living in this loud, noisy area that it seemed to become.
Right, just since we've been here.
Because Maggie didn't used to react like that. We went the first year and a half with her watching things peacefully go by out the window, whether it was a loud truck or whether it was a child or a dog walking by. Now any little thing just turns her. And I feel like you and I have way less tolerance for things as we get more frustrated living in this loud place, you know?
So I wonder if there's a lot of different things. I mean, I wonder if we could work on ourselves and see if that changes Maggie's behavior. You know, like say when the, you know, something happens where she's trying to discharge that energy when she sees a dog mm-hmm. walking outside or some loud noise. You know, I wonder, I mean, that would ultimately be, if your dog is your mirror, that would ultimately be the solution, the root cause.
Sure.
It's really just us. And then you can do these other training things that he talked about to help modify their behavior. But yeah, I think that's where the magic is. That's where the juice is.
I wonder if naturally, too, that just shows your progress in that area as a human being.
You mean if you've gotten better?
If you've gotten better and you don't even do anything to train the dog to react differently to the situation, but they just naturally change as well. That would be a crazy experiment to watch. The more mellow and in tune you get with not being bothered by things and letting things flow and roll off you.
Mm-hmm.
If the dog just stopped barking all of a sudden and nothing bothered him. And,
yeah.
I mean, that would be...
Becomes a little Buddha dog.
That'd be pretty cool though, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be. Wow.
My goodness.
So much there.
So much and so little time in a day. Doesn't
so
it seem
little
to be?
Time. I know. Kevin Behan, naturaldogtraining.com. And so we're hitting this from all angles. In episode number 216, we talked with Robert Mueller from barfworld.com. And we are going to be putting Maggie on a 90-day challenge. Starting with next week, with all kinds of amazing foods, organ meats and bones and
salmon oil.
Yeah, salmon oil, and really changing Maggie's diet. I mean, she eats a raw food diet now, but we're going to be sort of upgrading that. And so it's really cool. You have these two components. You have their dietary, what they eat, and then you have how you interact and train them and your relationship with them with Kevin Behan. And you're kind of hitting everything at both angles. And pretty cool.
Your dog's covered here on Extreme Health Radio.
Dog's covered. Yeah,
we got your dog covered.
That's right. Oh my gosh. So awesome. If you guys are interested in this subject and want to discuss further, you can always jump over to our forums and continue the discussions at extremehealthradio.com/forum. You'll see links to our site or to the forum on our website. So check that out if you want to, you know, have other people interact with your ideas and thoughts about what Kevin said. You can always do that. It's free to sign up and you can just join and all of that. And if you want to join our Facebook community as well, stay up to date with our shows, all you got to do is go to extremehealthradio.com/Facebook and hit the like button, and then you can see.
As you say, be off and running.
Be off and running. That's right. So thank you everybody for joining us. If you would like to support us in any way, we do take donations, as we said at the beginning of the show, or you can go to Amazon. If you go to extremehealthradio.com/donate, that would be a great way to support us. We rely heavily on your donations, and it's such an amazing way for us to keep the show free. And Kate is now down to one day a week at the salon.
We'll talk a little bit more about that. Tomorrow's free-for-all.
Yeah, we'll talk more about that. And so we really, really relish your support. So I want to thank you, everyone who has donated. It's just such a blessing. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much. And that's about it, right?
Yeah, let's go. Let's go treat Maggie with some cookies and re-strategize how to get her to mirror our better behavior that's coming in the future.
Yes, that's right. I love it. All right, guys, this is episode number 220. So thank you for joining us, and we'll catch you on the next episode.
Listening to this episode,
it's time to go for now, but our mission does not end with this show.
Justin and Kate will be back with another interview packed full of ideas, discoveries and unique ways to regain your health.
Head on over to extremehealthradio.com/subscribe and instantly download our free gift too that contains cutting edge strategies to start making healthy lifestyle changes today.
No material on this blog is intended to suggest that you should not seek professional medical care. Always work with qualified medical professionals, even as you educate yourself in the field of live food nutrition and alternative medicine. I'm not a doctor, nor am I offering readers or listeners medical advice of any kind. None of the information offered here should be interpreted as a diagnosis of any disease, nor an attempt to treat or prevent any disease or condition. While information in this blog and during this podcast is discussed in the context of numerous conditions, it can be dangerous to take action based on any of the information on this podcast or in this blog.